But now we need to look at what actually is in that law and what's happening with that implementation and what are the consequences coming down the road. So we put together a few things that, as I said, I worked for Newt Gingrich, for John McCain, Fred Thompson. You can probably guess my political affiliation, but at the same time, I do want to say that there are some positive things in the law. I think they could have been much broader. But at the same time, we wanted to put together a few visuals that we thought would help educate the public. And these are nonpartisan, these are straight facts, and the first one is this one. This is a timeline, and this actually doesn't do justice because we actually printed this off, and it's 10 feet wide by 5 feet high. There are about 500 of these little boxes here, color-coded by taxes or Medicare or Medicaid or reimbursement cuts or whatever they may be. It simply tells you the section of the law, a brief title, and then a one or two sentence explanation of the provision. So this is nonpartisan, this is just presenting the facts, and it runs from 2010 until 2020. Though I do think it's funny, if you look at this little box over here on the left, these are called pre-enactment deadlines, which are retroactive deadlines that had already passed when they signed the bill into law, but then went into effect retroactively. So I think Congress is the only place where you can do retroactive deadlines. So we have upwards of 500. And if you think about the experience in Utah setting up your health insurance exchange, just to give you an indication of how complex this is, health insurance exchanges are a big provision of the reform law. They make up one box for health insurance exchanges. And you're going to have probably tens of thousands of pages of regulation to implement all this stuff. A lot of talk has been around one of these new demonstration projects called Accountable Care Organizations. That is one box. So just to tell you the complexity and the scale of this law is really, really remarkable. But just to put it into perspective, this is truly the prism that you have to look through when you see the future of healthcare. You have to look through this law to see what the future of healthcare is, because it really does impact every single stakeholder, from patients to doctors to businesses to employers to drug companies, you name it. And some are impacted more than others, but the government is going to be the lead driver of actually implementing this graph. And it certainly gives me pause to think that CMS and HHS can do this in a flexible, timely, open, transparent way. But another thing that we put together was this one here. This was also 50 square feet. And this one actually started because Newt got into a little match with the Secretary of Health and Human Services. He described the reform law as Soviet. He's been known to be a flamethrower now and again. So he described this as Soviet. And she replied in a Wall Street Journal editorial calling him out, saying, this is anything but Soviet, this is patient-centered, this is flexible, we're doing really good work here. So what we ended up doing was actually going through all 2,700 pages of the law and pulling out each individual grant of authority to the Secretary of HHS. And this is, again, what we did here is actually even more straightforward. We took the actual text. So each of these boxes represents one grant of authority. And we actually have the citation of the provision and the actual text from the legislation. It comes to almost 2,000 powers that the secretary will actually have. And some are very, very minor. Certainly wouldn't quibble to say all of them are wide-ranging. But the detail of the authority of the government to actually implement this law is pretty significant. One of my favorites is something called tooth-level surveillance. This is an actual term that is in the legislation that says the secretary shall have the power to determine tooth-level surveillance of dental hygienists and dentists and how they actually examine teeth. There's another one that says the secretary shall determine the processes of dispensing drugs in long-term care facilities. So some are fairly minor, but some are very minute. And we would argue, and I'm sure many in the healthcare sector would argue, that doctors and providers know more about delivering care than the secretary. But 2014 is actually the big year. This is why you see so much happening both in Congress and in the courts, why things are getting fast-tracked, is because the law is being implemented as we speak. and working up to 2014 when all of the major, major provisions go into effect. Medicaid expansion goes into effect on January 1, 2014. Health plans can no longer exclude individuals who have pre-existing conditions, so there's no need for the high-risk pool anymore. The subsidies are available, the mandate goes online, and when you think about the penalty for the mandate, it is pretty interesting in that if you look at this situation as a consumer and you don't have insurance, you're going to be faced with a choice, whether to buy insurance or pay a penalty. And insurance can obviously be pretty expensive, but when you compare it to paying a $95 fine or maybe, you know, a few hundred dollars if you're a low income, you may still opt to pay the fine and be uninsured, considering the alternative, which could be spending thousands of dollars on buying a policy. Yes, ma'am?
Is that $95 a month or $95 a year?
A year. $95 a year. It's very cheap. Well, I'll show you when we talk about the employer penalties, they run the same math. One thing I'd also point to before I get to that is the last bullet. This is also going to be a very, very intense battle. Minimum essential benefits. The federal government is going to require every insurance policy sold in the United States to have a certain minimum benefit set. And there are pros and cons to requiring that type of coverage, but the bottom line is the government is going to be the one that determines what's covered and what isn't. It won't be up to employers or insurers anymore. So what actually goes into that essential benefits is going to be a very, very bruising fight. Because typically in states where insurance has been regulated for many, many years, there are mandates already. You need to insure or offer chiropractic care or, you know, whatever it might be. But ultimately, all those mandates raise costs, and it'll be interesting to see how that battle plays out. 2014 is the first year for insurers and their industry fee. The health insurance exchanges come online in 2014, and that work has already begun in many, many states. But that last bullet is the one I was going to point to, something that is going to be a real, real problem. And that is that, you know, insurance in the United States is technically public sector, private sector. Medicare insures about 40 million Americans, Medicaid roughly the same amount. Private insurers insure upwards of 130 to 150 million Americans. We get our insurance through our employers. What this law does is actually, if you go back to the penalty that I mentioned, for an employer who doesn't offer qualified coverage, or if they do offer qualified coverage and one of their employees goes and gets a tax subsidy and actually uses it, the employer will be fined $2,000 per employee. So when you think about huge employers, you know, you think of AT&T or you think of General Electric or IBM, they're going to start running the numbers. In fact, this is one that I was just dumbfounded by. This was last year when Democratic Chairman of the House Energy and Commerce Committee, Henry Waxman, was going to hold a hearing on an issue similar to this. He subpoenaed some internal documents from a number of companies. This was from AT&T. And they actually started running the numbers. So in 2009, AT&T spent $4.7 billion in that year to provide insurance benefits to its employees. The penalty for not providing that coverage would total $600 million. So by dropping private coverage for their employees, AT&T could save $4 billion a year. You think about the economy, you think of the state of the economy, you think of the jobs market, you think of investments, that is a significant amount of savings. And even smaller companies, there's a medical group in Illinois that we talked with that they ran the similar numbers, and they ended up saying they could save upwards of $7 or $8 million a year. And for a small business, that is a huge, huge savings. And someone, I don't pretend to be an attorney, though I am married to one, said that there may actually be fiduciary responsibilities that public companies would actually have to drop their employee coverage, because shareholders could actually sue to say, well, you just passed up an opportunity to save us shareholders $4 billion a year, and you didn't do it. So there could be grounds for lawsuits against some companies. So you'll see employers doing this math. Do we keep coverage or do we drop coverage? And if they drop coverage and opt to pay the fine, those employees are going to get coverage through the exchanges. They're going to cash in tax credits. They may go on Medicaid, and that will simply increase the burden on the public sector through tax revenue. So that's something that really has to be addressed in the short term, because this is coming around the corner very, very quickly. There are a few things that I wanted to just close on, which is, I think what this whole effort has shown us is that there really is a misunderstanding about health insurance and the delivery of actual medical care. And there is a fundamental difference. I mean, insurance is really a reflection of the delivery of medical care. You know, when you think about auto insurance, we buy it to cover accidents. So it covers, you know, body shops and paint jobs and this and that. Health insurance is the same way. We pay for premiums, and it's supposed to cover everything that we may need if we need to access the healthcare system. One point that I think most folks miss is that if you don't fundamentally change the underlying system of medical care, it doesn't really matter what you have on top as the financing mechanism. You could have a government-run system. You could have the purest free market that you could design. But if the underlying system is broken, they're both designed to fail. So that's why I think the work at Intermountain is so powerful, is because they are doing it the right way. They are doing efficient, quality care. And so there are changes that absolutely have to happen on both fronts. We do need to have more market-based competition for insurance. We do need to have more transparency to know who's providing quality care and who isn't providing quality care. You know, does anyone want to go see the person who finished dead last in their medical school class? But we have no idea. I mean, there are good providers and there are terrible providers. There are good lawyers and bad lawyers, right, Doug? I mean, there are, you know, good policies and bad policies, but when it comes to transparency of actual providers, we have no idea. And the better providers usually provide better care at lower costs. So there are a number of things that can be changed. These are a few of them that weren't included in the reform law that can be revisited at any time. And so we're just hopeful that through people like Intermountain showcasing and advocating for who's doing it right can really be, I think, one of those important lessons to hopefully design the right policies that can ultimately transform the system.